We are proud members of the Spy Podcast Network. Find out more at www.spypodcasts.com.
Hello and welcome to Spy Hard's podcast, where your hosts go deep undercover into the world of spy movies to decipher which films make the knock list. But remember, this information is strictly for your ears only. I'm Agent Scott.
And I'm Cam the Provocateur. And Scott, gum! Gum! Gum!
Stick it under the table, Cam. I genuinely thought you'd introduce yourself as Poobah.
Oh, that's a good one as well. Yeah, yeah.
We'll get back to Poobah. But, Cam, I think we might have done it this week. We might have gone so obscure that we might actually delete our own podcast. What are we talking about?
We are talking about 1934's British Agent, directed by Michael Curtiz and starring Leslie Howard.
I have to believe these are names people know, but I don't.
We'll talk about Michael Curtiz, who one of the big old-school Hollywood directors. And Leslie Howard is in a lot of films of that era. Kay Francis as well. So it definitely has people who would be very recognizable at the time. But it's not really... This movie is not one that if you Googled their names, is in the first three or four mentions of their work.
It's interesting because I put a little tweet out about this episode earlier today, and we actually got some responses to it. People have seen it, and they
right.
did like. And there's actually a bit of trivia I've got for our breakdown section that I don't. It's not on IMDb.
Oh, I've had I had a far easier time finding trivia for this movie than say even probably Gotcha, something like that.
Wow, really? That's surprising, actually.
Oh, this one was really easy for me.
So there obviously is people who hold this film in high regard.
They hold it in regard.
They hold it.
They hold it.
like the gum.
Yeah.
Well, just to prove my point, in terms of being so obscure, we will just sort of invert, like dividing by zero. Let's look at the letterbox.com synopsis.
Okay. Is it now? I'm before you read it. I'm wondering if it's going to be a history lesson. Basically paragraph, or is it going to be, a one or two sentence character-driven plot summary? Let's find out, Scott. Go ahead.
Do you care to gamble?
No, I want to hear what it actually is. I think it's more fun just to let you read it.
Okay. British Agent, 1934. Please insert synopsis here.
Oh. They don't have a synopsis on Letterboxd, huh?
No, I'm kidding. It actually gets worse.
Oh, okay.
An Englishman falls in love with a Russian spy.
Okay. That's pretty vague. Did you pull up the IMDb one by any chance?
I can. I have it open just to maybe give it a second shot. I mean, this one... Oh. Oh. Do you remember pitching your tent?
Yeah, I do. Wait, hold on. Do I remember pitching a tent? I mean, I remember that joke from an episode. What was it in relation to again? Oh, that's right. Okay, it's coming back to me. It was the very long synopsis, and you weren't familiar with that very kind of dirty North American saying. Yes, okay.
Well, pitch a tent, folks. Here it comes. It's 1917. In Russia, the communist revolution is in full swing. Steve Locke is a British agent in Russia. The main task of Steve is to prevent the Bolsheviks, led by Joseph Stalin, to sign in Petrograd a separate treaty with the Germans. Germany had been at war with its neighbours. Steve has to deal with Eleanor Moura, the attractive secretary of Lenin, and a spy too. Steve falls in love with Elena.
That's better.
Well, it's not. It's not a synopsis. It's like a narrative retelling of the story.
Yeah, I mean, This is a really tough one, I think, because if you were alive in 1934, I think the events that transpire in it in terms of Russian history would be a little better known just through the, you know, the press at the time. Mm-hmm. Visiting this movie in 2022, I think a lot of viewers would be kind of baffled as to what's going on.
Yeah, I had to call up my brother, who is a history major. He actually teaches history, ancient history, but he knows a lot about the both world wars. Just to sort of get, you know, the actual historical line on what happened and maybe contextualize it a little bit. I don't have anything to sort of recite. I would just tell people to go check it out on Wikipedia. But the Bolshevik uprising in Russia, this is based off of a real story, I suppose, is the point of our discussion here. Although I do like the phrase pitching a tent when it comes to synopsis now. Or maybe we, like the really short ones, we call them the British agent.
Yeah, the British agent, yeah.
Yeah, and then the long ones are called pitching a tent.
Now, I have a question for you. You know, you are Agent Scott on this podcast, and you are British. When you knew you were tackling British agent, were you hoping for more of a movie that could reflect on your own persona, the one you could hold up and be like, British agent? That's me.
Well, I actually wouldn't want someone based off of me as a British agent, because people who wear like lounge pants 90% of the day. And yeah, I don't think I've ever worn a tuxedo in my life. I'm probably not the poster boy for British agents.
Right. Okay. Fair enough.
But I would much rather be Stephen Locke. He seems like a man who's got it sussed out.
Yeah. Yeah. He seems very capable.
Although I would like to be called Pooh Bah.
Wouldn't we all?
But I think we should take a seat on this lamppost and figure out how the hell we got British agent.
Right. Yeah, because neither one of us have seen this movie before, so we don't have any earlier experiences other than me just being quite familiar with the work of some of the participants in the movie, but yeah.
And a little bit of inside baseball. Usually I would say that bit Cam just said before, but we had a different film prepared for this episode, but it just turns out you can't get it anywhere. So this was like a last minute pivot. So we had to sort of pick this film out from our list. But we had a lot of prep. I think Cam even watched a film of the director we were going to watch in preparation, and then didn't even cover it in the end.
Yeah, I'll give a little teaser for those that feel like doing some secret agent work of their own. I watched the movie Destination Moon from 1950. I will leave it at that.
Ooh. You are the true British agent.
Indeed.
But yeah, let's take a seat on this lamppost. Spill the beans.
Okay, so British Agent was based on a book by R.H. Bruce Lockhart, who was a British diplomat, journalist, footballer, author, and secret agent.
Oh boy.
Uh-huh.
What a CV.
That's right. I mean, you go back in time and you look at like the CVs of like, say like Leonardo da Vinci. He has like 12 jobs. If you ask me, I have got like, I don't know, two. It's very unimpressive.
Do you count podcaster as one of the two jobs?
I am going to, yeah.
Yeah, I suppose I've only got two.
We're very unimpressive.
Does dog dad count?
No.
Oh.
No.
Okay. Definitely two then. Yeah, I aspire to the author's set of skills.
Right.
Particular set of skills.
So nonetheless, Lockhart worked for the British Foreign Service. And he was part of a failed effort to sabotage the Bolshevik Revolution in Moscow in 1918 by breaking up a potential peace deal between Russia and Germany. There was concern at the time that if Russia and Germany, you know, made peace, that Russia would release German prisoners of war, who would then flood back out and cause a lot of problems for the British during World War I. And so that was kind of the notion of what was going on. And so Lockhart was going to try to prevent this peace deal from taking place. He was working unofficially. The government was going to disavow any knowledge of him doing any of this, but that was essentially what he was doing. So his job was basically to make a tough sell to Lenin without the official backing of the British government. And Bruce Lockhart published an autobiography called Memoirs of a British Agent in 1932. This book was an instant bestseller. This was like something of a phenomenon in 1932. And so Warner Brothers snapped up the rights very quickly. And their hope was that Barbara Stanwyck would star as the Elena Mora character, because Stanwyck was a huge star of this era. But she turned it down. But like Warner Brothers was just trumpeting this story as some of their quotes from the time: the greatest human document of the century, the most important dramatic event of the year. This was also the most expensive film in Warner Brothers history at the time when they were making this. Like, they believed in the story of Bruce Lockhart.
Wow. Okay, that's a lot to take in just at the early stage of this briefing section. So, okay, the most Warner Brothers have spent. Now, I can argue that's probably true. I think that is on the screen. I think you can see that.
Yeah.
The quote about the book, did it say in the last century?
Greatest human document of the century.
Of the century. I was just trying to think of what else came out in the last 100 years since the 1930s.
Yeah, because you've got to look at it from the point of view of like 1932 or 3.
I'm sure there's a few good novels. I was thinking like, oh, the Bible's probably going to win that argument, but the Bible was made a long time ago.
Right.
Okay. All right. I'll accept that for now.
And The Lord of the Rings was like a decade later.
There's definitely got to be more, though. Like, you know, War and Peace, stuff like that. Isn't that all pre this?
I'd have to start looking up these dates. I don't know. When was Crime and Punishment? Yeah, I don't know.
Fair enough. Well, yeah. Please continue.
So the book was actually very critical of Great Britain. And so when British censors found out that Warner Brothers was going to make this into a movie, they were like, hold on, slow your roll, be very careful, and start filing down the edges, or this movie may not be playing in Britain. And so that was something that was very much taken into account when they adapted the book into the movie, was to not make it critical of Great Britain, because obviously they wanted the money that would come from a Great Britain audience, right?
Okay, I'm wondering what the book was sort of critical about, because they do sort of leave the Leslie Howard, Stephen Locke character kind of high and dry in Petrograd.
Yeah.
In the story. Like, they make a point of saying that, and he does make a couple of small jabs at the British government, I would say.
Well, I think this is the moment where you want to make your big announcement that you are actually going to read the book, British Agent, and do a solo commentary on the film that will drop next week, right?
Yeah, that's a Patreon exclusive. I'm sure you'll all be diving to your nearest Patreon websites to subscribe. I'll put it behind our £100 tier, just so only the true spyhards can hear it.
That's right. So they brought in screenwriter Laird Doyle. Now, his career had started in 1932 with a film called The Phantom Express about a mystery on a rail yard. And he would do a number of very star-driven films. Like, he did a Jimmy Cagney movie called Jimmy the Gent. He did a William Powell movie called The Key. And then he followed up The Key with this film. And he actually died just 2 years later in 1936 at the age of 29 after an airplane crash.
Wow. Which actually kind of connects him to the star of this film, who has quite a tragic early death too.
Well, you know what? Let's keep the tragedy train going, because this movie also had dialogue contributions from Pierre Collings, who was a writer who'd started in 1925 with a movie called Woman of the World. And he had later on, with his penultimate film, done a film called The Story of Louis Pasteur, which he won 2 Oscars for Best Original Story and Best Screenplay. He did this film and just, you know, worked on the dialogue and did not get credit for it. But he died in 1937 at the age of 37 from pneumonia. There is a curse on British Agent.
I'm glad I didn't see myself as British Agent then. Otherwise, it'd be coming after me next.
Yeah. So, yeah, like a lot of just tragedy with the writing credits on this film. But let's talk a bit about the director. Now, the director is Michael Curtiz. He was born in Budapest, and he was a director and actor initially. And, you know, he got his start in 1912 in a movie called Today and Tomorrow. And at that point, he was working under his birth name, which was Curtiz Mihaly. And he became very prolific in Hungary. He shot 38 films, you know, for his home country. And then I said he was very prolific. Now, Scott, what do you think is the most number of movies he shot in a single year?
Most number of films in a single year. Now, given the average length of a film at this point was a lot shorter.
Yeah, it's in the era of shorts, and yeah. also the era of silent films, which silent films are often, you know, 45 minutes to an hour.
Okay. And how many would the average director now put out a year?
I mean, nowadays, at best, two.
Okay. I'm going to go with six.
13.
Wow. My man's busy.
In the year 1917, he did 13 films.
That's like two sets at once. That's got to be running between things to direct them.
Yes.
Fair play.
So in the early 1920s, he began directing for other European countries and adopted the name Michael Curtiz with 1924's General Babka. And it was shortly after this period that he caught the eye of Warner Brothers head Jack Warner. And so he ended up moving to America in 1926 and launched his career with Warner Brothers with a film that's fairly forgotten called The Third Degree. But over the course of his career, he'd become incredibly prolific as an American director as well and had an incredibly versatile career. And he did movies like Captain Blood with Errol Flynn. He did The Adventures of Robin Hood, also with Errol Flynn. He did Yankee Doodle Dandy with Jimmy Cagney. He did Casablanca, White Christmas. You go through this guy's filmography, you are just going to see an endless string of classic old Hollywood films that I think the reason you don't necessarily know the name Michael Curtiz is because he didn't have sort of that Hitchcock distinctive style. He was not a John Ford. He was a guy who could take on pretty much any project and really elevate the material, but would kind of adjust his style and stamp depending on the material. So he's incredibly important in old Hollywood, but not the iconic visual stylist I think we think of when we start looking at auteurs.
He's more of a Ron Howard.
He's better than a Ron Howard, but he definitely fits that sort of mold, yes.
Able to adapt to what you need him to do, but not really flashy enough that has his own style.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Just like one of the great craftsmen, almost even maybe like a bit of a Richard Donner as well.
Okay. Well, I mean, I've seen Casablanca and White Christmas, so even I've come across him, I guess. Mm-hmm. I didn't recognize the name, but I'm terrible at that stuff anyway. But okay, so right, I now know the director did this film. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, and his final film was the John Wayne Western, The Comancheros, in 1961. He actually lived a decent life. He passed away in 1975, just 1 year after The Comancheros in 1962. At the end, though, he had 178 directing credits.
That's like an aspirational number for... that's an aspirational number for like a good director.
That's the sort of number you see with like character actors.
Yeah, when you go on their IMDb and they've just done like a TV episode, a TV episode, a TV episode. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That would almost seem like it was not fake, but like, manipulated.
Right. And I mean, there were other directors who were incredibly busy. John Ford made a ton of films as well. I think if you worked in that silent era, you were just like shooting things constantly. So that definitely racks up the numbers. Hitchcock also did a, you know, reasonably high number of films. But nowadays you see directors who look at Quentin Tarantino. He's done, you know, like basically he's going to do his 10th film and call it a day. And that's since 1992. And you compare that to like a Curtiz who was doing like 13 films in a year.
I've done 10 last week. What are you talking about, son? Yeah,
that's right. At you know, that era, they weren't as precious about their art. They were there to work for the studio. And in the case of Curtiz, he got a lot of great scripts and knew how to shoot them incredibly well.
But also there was less pressure in a sense where like, you know, you can get a, it sounds like you can get a film done in a month. If you go by 13, it's close to a month.
Yeah.
So if you're constantly working, yeah.
Not a lot of like 18-month films in those days like there are now.
You're not sitting around trying to get the mocap on Tom Holland just right.
Exactly. So Jack Warner really believed in this project. As I said, it was incredibly expensive for Warner Brothers, and he was even trying to send a film crew to Russia for a location shoot, and those requests were denied, so it did not happen.
Well, it had happened by that point. The Bolsheviks had taken over, I think, by that point.
And, yeah.
Yeah. So that makes sense. The whole like decadence of Western civilizations was kind of frowned upon at that point, I believe.
Yeah, I think that may have been a bit of a pipe dream that was going to be the case, that they'd be allowed
makes
to
a good,
do that.
Makes a good press clipping, I suppose.
Oh, definitely. And also, you know, you had the star Kay Francis, who was a pretty major talent of her time, but it was actually during production of this movie that she had a life-threatening injury. It was not while working. It was an evening after a day of production, and she severed an artery in her right hand, and she said it was from breaking a window because she forgot her keys, and she barely survived. It was her maid that actually was able to fashion a tourniquet, but much was said that this was also potentially a suicide attempt. It was never confirmed, but if you look up a lot of biographies, they kind of talk about Kay Francis and just some of her health issues, and it seems like it's one of those question marks that's a little suspicious.
Okay. Well, that's sad to hear.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of tragedy with British Agent, right?
Well, yeah. And I mean, we haven't got back to it, but like Leslie Howard had quite an interesting career himself because he was also a spy.
Yeah.
And then died during World War II as a spy. Quite the strange web this film has woven.
Yeah, just one of those weird coincidences where it's just like everyone affiliated with this movie seemed to have a lot of issues, except for Michael Curtiz, who seemed to make it out okay. But yeah, very interesting.
And then Poobah, like what?
Poor Poobah. So as I said, the budget was very high on this one. They spent $475,000 in, you know, $1932 or $34. So that's quite expensive. Domestically, it did $532,000. International, $390,000 for a worldwide total of $922,000. And I did the inflation calculator on that. It's about $20 million nowadays.
It's so bizarre that you... Like, there's films that we try and track from, like, the 60s, and you can't find anything.
Yeah.
For this, you've got the whole international and, you know, domestic.
Uh-huh.
That's crazy. Why is it with just this film? Like, what's up? Is it because it was a hit, I suppose?
There was actually a Kay Francis fan site that had done the research on this and actually talked to people, I think at like the UCLA film department and whatever. They'd been able to track down actual figures for this one. That's not the case for most movies. I think this was just luck of the draw because someone out there was very invested in Kay Francis. And I'll post a link to their page in the show notes for this episode because it was very helpful and has a lot of information on her just as a talent, more than we'll be able to go into just in this review. But I did find a quote. They said that this was higher than usual profits. So like, if you look at that number and go like, I don't know, is that that much? They said at the time it was higher than usual profits for a Warner Brothers film. So it was a hit. But when you actually hear the number 20 million in comparison to what movies make nowadays, you kind of shrug, but you know, it was what it was. How much are they charging for movies in 1934? Like 5 cents?
Stick of gum?
Yeah. Gum?
Gum?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. I it was weird when you said like 900,000-ish, but it felt like it was a hit.
Mm-hmm.
Like just from watching this film, it felt like it must have done well.
It did well enough. Yeah, like it was considered a solid hit, but there's a reason that you're not necessarily as familiar with it, because the top three for this year you had, number one was It Happened One Night, number two was Cleopatra, and number three was One Night of Love, which is a romantic drama starring opera singer Grace Moore that, coincidentally, I watched last week.
Really?
Total coincidence. I have a list of Oscar movies, Best Picture nominees, that I haven't seen, and I've been just kind of checking them off over the last couple of years. I had a free evening, but I had to work really early the next day, so I looked up on my list what was the shortest one I could watch, and One Night of Love was like 82 minutes, and I said, I'm pulling the trigger and watching it.
That's 82 minutes of love right there.
It's a lot of opera, Scott. It's about 40% opera singing.
Did it feature a candle at any point?
I don't think so. There might have been a candle, actually. Maybe there was, actually. But the reason I cited like that top three, more so It Happened One Night in Cleopatra. Those are movies that actually continue to have a legacy. People have heard of them now. They'll talk about, especially It Happened One Night, which is on the Criterion Collection and one of the great romantic comedies. That movie's still talked about. Whereas British Agent, despite being, you know, very expensive, kind of interesting just in the legacy of Warner Brothers, not particularly well known. And actually, if you look it up on Rotten Tomatoes, I don't think there's any reviews whatsoever for it.
There's quite a few on IMDb, but they're all user submitted, so that doesn't surprise me particularly.
Yeah.
But, That is strange, though. I mean, do you know where this film fell over the year?
No.
Like, as in where the ranking is? No, it's so hard to tell.
It's impossible to get a really solid, say, like, top 50 from that kind of era. Like, you had a sense, if you look it up, you'll find, like, maybe a top 6, maybe at best a top 10, but like the It Happened One Night, Cleopatra, like they were such juggernauts that it was very clear that they were way out in front of everything else.
And just to maybe before we get to the review, just to sort of contextualize where we are, because we don't often stray back to the 30s and 40s, although we should come here more. I think this is some very interesting stuff to look at. And we have a ton of films from these eras to delve into. I mean, just off the top of my head, what else have we done in the 30s? The Man Who Knew Too Much originally, 39 Steps, Mata Hari.
I think that's all we've covered on this show. I believe The House on 92nd Street was the 40s. We've done a couple 40s, but I think of the 30s, you've just named them all.
Okay. Yeah, we should come back to the 30s, I think. So it's quite an interesting time.
We've got a couple Hitchcocks. Secret Agent, I think, is in the 30s, at least. There are a few others. There is a Marlene Dietrich movie we're going to talk about at some point. The problem is, for some of these 30s ones, is availability, because we want these movies to be available to you, the listener, so you can actually watch them along with us. And some of them are just kind of in an archive somewhere, waiting to, you know, show up. Probably not on a major streaming service, but maybe even something like Tubi TV or something.
You usually get quite lucky with some of these early ones that they turn up on YouTube.
Yeah.
I think at least the hit. I think one of the Hitchcocks we did was on YouTube.
This movie as well.
Oh, is it on YouTube? I managed to find it on streaming here in the UK.
I paid for the $4.99 rental just because I wanted a better quality copy.
Yeah, the stream I found wasn't particularly good, so that was maybe a wise decision. But yeah, so you can get it here now. I was reading a quick review on IMDb the other day, and the chap said like you just can't get it where he was. So he had to, like, import a DVD.
Right.
He went to a lot of work to watch British Agent.
It's one of the bummers of the streaming era, at least for me as, like, a real film fan, which is that, like, streaming seemed to offer all of the opportunities to get all of these classic films. And if anything, they've in some ways made it harder, where they've said, we don't want anything old. We want stuff from, you know, right now up until maybe the 80s, even the 70s is spotty. It's really like they want the 80s upwards. And so what I really hoped was when things like HBO Max launched and stuff was they'd just be like, here's the entire Warner Brothers classic archive. And that's not really been the case.
It's weird because we've got a really good channel here in the UK called Talking Pictures TV. And they just show, I mean, they do show up to like the 80s. They do a lot of B movies, B sci-fi gets played a lot on there. But they'll do the odd spy film two or three times a week, and they have played The House on 92nd Street.
Right.
You know, they go that obscure. So we've got that, which is nice. But after that, we're in the same position as you, the Netflixes and the Amazon Primes of the world. Now, Amazon Prime has some dross on it. Don't, trust me on that. But it doesn't really do old films.
Not for free. Usually you have to pay a rental charge, yeah. And there are great stuff out there. Like the Criterion streaming channel obviously offers a lot. And there are a few other specialty ones. But the hope was always that things like an Amazon Prime or especially the studio specific ones like HBO Max would just be like, here's the whole archive. Go nuts.
Which is odd because I'm sure it's all digitized.
One would think, yeah.
Like you could just, it's like flick a switch. But
yeah,
alas, we're not in charge of these streaming networks. I think we should talk about this film, Cam.
Yeah, I had actually one other note I'll make, just in case anyone was confused, because I talked a lot in the notes about Warner Brothers. When you watch the movie, it has the big production slate for First National Pictures off the bat.
Yeah.
And I was confused by this when I watched the movie, because I actually did the research in advance, and I was like, First National Pictures? So I looked this up. It was a production company earlier in the 1900s, and Warner Brothers acquired it. I believe it was 1928, and they would use it for very specific movies. So things like more serious dramas, things like that. It was kind of more their prestige pictures. They would put the First National Pictures slate on it, but they would retire it a little bit later down the road and just go full on Warner Brothers.
So it was like a Miramax or something like that.
Yeah, the way that Miramax owns, say, Dimension. So Dimension would put out spy kids in a lot of genre films, especially horror stuff or sci-fi, even though they all are under the Miramax umbrella.
But Miramax is owned by someone else, isn't it?
Disney, yeah. So it gets more complicated, but nonetheless, yeah.
Right, okay. Okay, I remember seeing that, but then I didn't know about the Warner Brothers thing. So I had never heard of First Nations Pictures before, though.
I'm sure I've seen a movie with that production slate on it, but it's not a super common one.
No. Well, this is a rare one because, as I said at the beginning of the chat, we hadn't spoken about this film. It was like a last-second decision to pull this film out from our list. So Cam and I haven't even discussed it at this point at all. So Cam, I'm deadly curious. What did you think of British Agent?
I found this film... I kind of gave a little bit of a clue up front where I said, like, the historical aspects of this movie can be quite complicated. At least for me, I did not have an ultra, ultra strong knowledge of what was going on in Russia during World War I. And so this movie kind of assumes you know. It does have mm-hmm. these, you know, cards that will give information, but they're a little vague. And so I found a lot of the movie, intellectually, you had to really pay attention and try to follow that. And it felt like often the plot was driven far more by historical detail than characters. And I found aspects like that a little frustrating. When we look at 1930s movies, some have aged really well. Like, I think you can look at The 39 Steps and be like, wow, that still really plays. It has momentum. I don't know that this movie has momentum, but I found it fairly consistently interesting in terms of the story it was telling. I mean, it's not dumbed down. It's a movie that I think, you know, you have to pay attention. It's at least giving you a snapshot of a time in history that's interesting, and I didn't know that much, but it made me more interested. So in a way, it did its job. It actually made me want to go and look, you know, read on Wikipedia what was going on at the time, and I'm more interested now in watching other films set during that time period and learning more about it. So in that respect, it did its job. As drama, it's a little wonky. You know, it has the snapshot time and place stuff that I think is often played very well. I said this movie was expensive. I think it has some really interesting, you know, restagings of riots and things like that. But as sort of a character-driven film, it's a little stiff. It's a little talky. I mean, it's very talky. It is a very, very talky movie. And it also has, at the core of it, a romance that does not work for me. It's incredibly melodramatic. And it was sort of modeled on not a relationship, but like the Kay Francis character was sort of an amalgamation of a few people, including a woman that that Lockhart was dating at the time. I don't know if he married her. I can't remember the full story there, but it was a woman he was having a relationship with, but it's also combined with a few other things. I like the idea of a female spy character that has this sort of conflicted relationship with him, but it is like the swooning love story within 3 minutes of them meeting, and it never really sells.
I was hoping you would come in here with a slightly different opinion,
mm-hmm.
I have to say. But I honestly can't argue with any of your points.
Yeah.
I'm always quite hesitant with older films. We know this on the show if you've been following along, but Cam, you certainly know this anyway. I always look at House of 92nd Street as a reason why. That's like the perfect encapsulation of what I think an old film is like. This isn't like that.
No.
This isn't. This is I wrote down this film is going at breakneck speed.
It's 80 minutes.
Not just the fact that it's 80 minutes. It fits like what would be a 3-hour film in Hollywood now into 80 minutes. And I wouldn't say it doesn't do it successfully. I think it tells its story successfully. I just don't think it has anything for you to connect to. It's like you're reading a book, but it's a history book. There's no actual like romance. It's not a dramatization. It's basically like a docudrama, I suppose, in that sense. It's not, but yeah, you're watching it, and you kind of you're introduced to Leslie Howard, and he's like, okay, I can get behind this guy. That's fine. He meets Elena. He saves her from one of the Russian guards or police officers or whatever he was. Soldiers, perhaps.
I think they refer to him as a Cossack, so yeah.
Yes, you're right. It's the Cossacks, yes. Right. Saves him from them, and they're immediately in love. And it's not just like a blossoming romance. It's, you know, she's willing to give up her communism for him. And she, you know, communism at that point was quite the, I don't want to say cult, but, you know, quite the, it was quite a following. It was quite a powerful movement, let's say that. And for her to give that up was quite a statement, and I don't think they earned that at all. Whereas the entire film is based around caring about what happens to these star-crossed lovers, you know, capitalism versus communism versus the heart, which sounds nice. But when you're, like, barreling through this 80-minute film trying to tell this, you know, quite a long story of espionage in Russia, which is quite this cool little side of history that no one really talks about. Like, when I approached my brother to give me sort of the lowdown, he's like, I've never really spoken about this. We don't teach it in school.
Yeah.
Quite interesting. He cares about it because he likes that sort of side of history. And I don't think I've ever heard of a Russian spy story in this era. So on that sense, they're giving us a cool story. I think there was a better way to deliver it than this.
Did you find just the historical events very burdensome to try to navigate?
Well, I had to. I watched it the first time. Luckily, it's 80 minutes, as we said.
Yeah.
I just sat through the first watch. I was like, okay, I guess like the title cards you mentioned are kind of helpful. Like three or four times in the film, they give you these little exposition dumps, which is helpful. But like I was sort of just like shrugging at it, really. Like I was pretending it wasn't particularly important. But when I go back to think about it, knowing the history is very important to this film. Like you need to know who Lenin is. If you don't know who Lenin is, it doesn't make any sense.
No, that's very true. And even like Trotsky as well, who plays a pretty significant role. And I mean, I think at the time, if you were an audience member going to this, the book is a bestseller and caused quite a stir, apparently. So I would imagine a fair number of people would have read the book, but they'd also be much more aware of World War I history, I would think, because they would have been very, you know, they would have been tracking what's going on at that time versus removed almost 100 years.
Well, it's like if I asked you...
Over 100, yeah.
Yeah. Well, if I asked you what was happening in the Middle East, if I asked you what was happening in the Middle East 10 years ago, you could maybe tell me who were the powers at that point.
Right.
And what was happening, roughly. And if I told a story in that and I painted my picture within that canvas, you'd probably follow along because you're aware of popular culture and news and Russia and the United States and NATO and terrorism, all that sort of stuff sort of intertwined into that section of the world. But yeah, rewatching it now, if I sat someone down, like if this made the knock list, for instance, it would have to go on the knock list with, like, a guidebook.
Yeah, and as people that cover spy films, we tackle a lot of Cold War stuff. Mm-hmm. So, like, the Russia of, like, you know, the 1960s and 70s and 80s and all that sort of stuff is something we experience time and time again on this podcast, whether through serious films or James Bond. You know, like, they will touch on it in ways. So you kind of absorb some of the information, the necessary information, just through osmosis of watching some of these movies. Whereas the World War One era was where I struggled with this movie. And it did, I struggle because as a work of like film storytelling, I don't think it's that successful because I think it would just genuinely confuse a lot of people in terms of aging. Maybe in 1934, people were like, I'm on board 100%. I understand all of this. But played now, it's very confusing and it doesn't have kind of that sweep of history that I think we've been kind of taught to kind of, you know, watch. Nowadays, when you see a film set in a you know, past era, they, I think, do a pretty solid job conveying what was going on at the time in a way that audiences can kind of soak up very easily. This film throws a lot at you. And so in that regard, it's not a movie that I think plays dramatically as well as it should. It doesn't have a lot of momentum for, you know, Stephen Locke's mission. And I guess they changed the name from Lockhart to Locke. I don't know why. They should have just kept Lockhart. But nonetheless, there's not a lot of like propulsiveness to what he's doing. Mm-hmm. You're more kind of just observing this snapshot of history and what one guy was sort of doing at the time. When we watched a movie like Bridge of Spies, which kind of a similar story in some ways, of a guy who off the books is journeying into, you know, Russian territory to try to broker something, I think that movie does a far better job just dramatically pulling you into his story versus this film, which is a little more, you kind of watch it somewhat emotionally removed.
I would agree with your point. One thing I was sort of thinking while you were talking, and something I sort of noted to myself in my own review and my notes, is I can hear people who are listening to this going, well, that's unfair. Because we know, say for instance, if this story was told and it was about what was happening in World War One, and it was in the UK, or it was in North America, I feel like we would feel more connected to it. But because it's connected to a state neither of us are particularly aware of the history of, we are instantly going, well, I don't understand it. But that's more our lack of knowledge hindering our experience and our enjoyment of the film than necessarily the film's lack of delivery. But what I will say is I think the film still fails to convey the message and to sort of contextualize where the film is.
And it's also an American film, right? Like, it's a Warner Brothers production being pitched to, in that case, predominantly, I guess, a North American audience, although, you know, obviously Great Britain was very important to them as well, given that they were willing to make concessions to, you know, appease the censors. So it really, if it's a movie coming out of Russia, I would view it very differently versus something that's being pitched as something that will be playing in a theater to a general audience in, you know, North America.
Is this like the 30s version of dating itself? Like, is this the, like, I don't know, a modern drama, and someone walks up and goes, yo, 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 homies, what's up?
In some ways, yes. In terms of the storytelling, I think there's a staginess to some of it, as well as just, I think things like some of the romance aspects are very dated. But there's other movies of this era that you'll come across that are just very creaky in terms of a craftsmanship level, and that's not the case here. I think this one, its sort of frustrations for me are more storytelling driven, and just the characters are very thin. Like, I would just like to know more about the characters and visit them in a way where it's not based around melodrama. I would like to just get to know them more as individuals, and the movie doesn't give me that. So I guess in that regard, yes, it's kind of a simplistic approach. That part's aged, but I think in terms of like an 80-minute movie, this did not feel like I was watching something super creaky and awkward.
No, I agree. I think it's successful in trying to keep your attention. You're not like staring at your phone throughout. But I don't care about the romance between the two of them. I almost would rather it had been 90 minutes and I had 5 more minutes for each character just to give them some life.
I think it would be just as compelling if they just forged like a friendship. And again, this is a 1930s movie. That's not going to be the case between a male and a female character. That's not what a major studio was going to give an audience ultimately. But it was even just like the way they framed it. And like they have the meeting, as you said, where she has shot a Cossack who is attacking a woman, wanders onto the embassy to try to just, you know, find some safety, stumbles into him. And you're like, okay, they have some sparks. I'll buy it. You know, these are two attractive actors. I'm willing to buy that these two people could be, you know, they could have some sparks. But the way they kind of frame it where they're just like hanging out at an apartment making coffee and he's like, the whole bean holds the flavor in. And she's like, oh my God. She is just swooning as this guy's like talking about whole beans and flavor. And I'm like, okay. And there's also a scene even before that where they run into each other at a tavern. And I like that sequence where there's like a tavern singer. It has a lot of atmosphere where the diplomats go to hang out because they're not really doing anything otherwise. And
I will stop you just because you're on that. I was going to come back to that scene, but yeah, because you mentioned it. Did you find that to be the weirdest cut in the entire film?
No, I have another one. So why is that one weird to you?
Well, it's just like they're all sat at a table going, Stephen Locke's quite sad. And then one goes, let's go to the gypsy bar. Swoosh! Like, you're in the gypsy bar, like, instantaneously, and they're blaring music in your face. I jumped the first time they did it. I didn't know how they got there. I was like, what is this?
That one didn't faze me. I'll reveal mine in a sec. But so they, you know, meet at this tavern. Again, nice set. It's I really actually like the location. And then they leave, and they're just like, he just like aggressively kisses her out of nowhere. And you're like, whoa, pull up.
I think he was pulling up.
Oh, no kidding. And it's like they'd known each other for maybe an hour at that point.
Maybe that's just how people flirted back in the 30s.
Maybe, because it turns into from there, from after their, you know, their kiss and the coffee bean talk, it is like, I love you. I've never met anyone else like you, and I want to be with you for the rest of my life. And that is kind of what carries them through the rest of the movie.
Well, I will just say it's clear that you're not a coffee drinker, Cam, because if someone starts talking to me about the whole bean, well, oof. Oh boy, hold me back.
That's how you met your fiance.
Right. There was a joke there I'm not going to make. Thank you. I'll move on. Let's talk about some things that we liked, because we're kind of bagging on the film a little
bit. I'll just name my most awkward cut.
I was going to come back to you because I figured it'd be in the dislikes, but okay.
I've got other things. So
All right. Go on.
The awkward cut for me was there's a section where he has made the pitch as to, you know, how they could hold off this peace treaty. He's going to offer them, you know, money and munitions and all that. It does this cut to London, and we get this like tinkly music as it shows like the London setting, and it has like, you know, some of the muckety mucks in London, and they say, something must be done. Cut. And it cuts away immediately. And I was like, whoa, what was that?
I went and looked. This film does have an editor.
Yeah.
Someone professionally edited this together.
You know what? I'm going to cut some slack on the editing of a 1934 film.
If it made us both jump, I think it's a bit... It's comical at best.
Yeah, it's a little awkward.
Yeah. I will remember this. I will even call that a British agent cut if I ever see it again. I'm naming a lot of things after this film. I'm going to keep this gag going for many weeks. Don't worry about that.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special report.
Calling all agents. Independent podcasting, much like the spy game, requires considerable resources. Whether it's research, equipment, hosting, or of course constructing a top secret volcano lair, we're putting out the call for your support.
That's right. As you may know, we've activated the Spyhards Patreon, home of our ever-growing lineup of Agents in the Field episodes where we decode non-spy films from your favorite spy actors and full film commentaries with more intel than a Basil exposition briefing.
Cam, what have we got in our crosshairs this month?
Well, the Thunderball commentary is live and we are tackling The Pink Panther from 1963.
And if that sounds delicious, then become a true Spyhard today and join the circus at patreon.com/spyhards. But before this message self-destructs, Cam, resume the spy jinx. Let's talk about likes, and I'm going to start. I liked that this film didn't suffer fools. It reminded me a lot of Funeral in Berlin in that sense. It does reward you paying attention. Paying attention, reading those title cards, listening to the dialogue, which does explain some of the stuff, not all of it. But I think if you watch the film and pay attention to everything, you can get somewhat of a good experience out of it. I'm so used to watching films these days. I haven't seen Doctor Strange at this point, but I can only imagine there's so many lines of exposition in that film that it's insane.
I would imagine so. I mean, most movies now are very exposition heavy, and this movie is to a degree as well. A lot of what's going on is the characters describing the historical aspects. But I think why it kind of works, and it kind of ties into something I like about the movie, is that you actually have these recreations of historical moments, like the riots and, you know, the revolution kicking in. And that sort of stuff, it was staged very well in ways that I found genuinely involving to watch. So even though they were giving me, you know, it was often a very talky movie, I felt like I was at least getting some payoff to it versus, you know, remember when we talked about Operation Crossbow and there was like scenes where there was those dudes standing around a table talking for like 17 minutes straight and you're like, I get it. Whereas in this case, I was actually quite thankful when it cut back to the guys around the table because they could explain to an idiot like me what's going on.
I suppose on the flip side of that, it makes you feel like you have to take notes.
And I was.
And some people want to go, well, there you go. Some people want to go to the theaters and just be like, just show me a Nick Cage action film.
Right.
Okay, cool. I'm going home. And that was it. That's their interaction with the film, which is absolutely fine. It's more or less how I visit the cinemas. But I think maybe I was in the mood for it today. Maybe I was in the mood for a film that actually pushed you a little bit. But I had to go and speak to my brother to get the contextualization because the film didn't give it to me.
And that's one thing on this show. I think we've encountered a few movies that have tackled, you know, times and places that we weren't ultra familiar with. And this movie, I'm sure there's better stories of this out there, but this one made me actually want to find something that was maybe a little more dramatically compelling for me. Like, this one kind of did its job as sort of a bit of a tester for me of like, oh, I'd like to know more about that.
Well, speaking of dramatically relevant, I think is what you said. I had another like.
Yeah.
Well, I have two likes. One's a silly one. And that is we got a connection to Comrade Veidt in The Spy in Black.
Okay. They referenced butter, didn't they?
Hell yes. The butter shortage of England, apparently. So I can understand the jubilation on Comrade Veidt's face. I mean, he is the man who smiles, and he was smiling when he saw that butter.
And I've got another connection. Conrad Veidt, jumping off of the butter. We're going to go from the butter to Conrad Veidt. Conrad Veidt was the inspiration for the Joker for his performance in The Man Who Laughs. And this movie featured a Joker actor.
No way.
The fellow with the mustache, who was one of the diplomats of the, you know, the, there was the group of four. The one with the mustache who played, I believe the character's name was Tito Del Val, was played by Cesar Romero, who played the Joker on the 1966 Batman show.
Boom.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that. Where's Ian from Cult Connections when you need him? That's a perfect one right there.
Yeah.
Get him on the show. Ah, I like that sort of stuff. That's good. But my other like, to bring us back, was the fact that the film didn't dwell... Actually, it kind of connects to your like, to be fair. It didn't dwell on characters. Not only did it off almost everyone,
yeah,
which is refreshing, but also, like, those people in the boardroom, they're there for 90 seconds in the entire film. It didn't need to keep going back to them. We didn't need more exposition. You can get it from someone else. It was about, like, there's a phrase for it that I'm forgetting. It's about, like, using your characters wisely.
Economical?
Yes. Yes, economical use of your characters. It didn't need to have anyone else for any longer than they stayed.
No.
And I appreciate that we were like, we're offing them to add dramatic stakes. You were killing people. And you weren't just cutting back to see what was going on with, who was the chap that was dying? Stalin.
Lenin.
No, Lenin. Sorry, it wasn't Stalin. Stalin was later. You weren't constantly going back to Lenin to see if he'd rolled over in bed and woken up from his coma. You got the one bit that he's ill. And then the update, he was okay at the end.
Mm-hmm.
I like that.
Yeah, well, it's like when a movie like this moves fairly briskly, and not in a way where it feels like it's been hacked to shreds. It just is a pretty fast-paced movie, because I can think of a movie like, say, like the Jonah Hex adaptation from a handful of years ago, which was clearly hacked to shreds and is 72 minutes, and you're like, I can't understand anything that's going on. That's not the case
72
here.
72 minutes?
Something like that, yeah. You remove credits, it's like 70-something minutes. But this movie is fast-paced, but it's intentionally fast-paced. It's trying to get across sort of the high-pressure situation that Stephen Locke's character, you know, Stephen Locke is in. And that it gets bogged down, I find, with the historical aspects, just my lack of familiarity. But in terms of being kind of a concise 80-minute story, it pulls that off. One thing I really like about this movie, and I wish it had been explored in a different angle. I would totally watch a movie about, you know, Kay Francis's character, Elena Moura, who was modeled on, you know, a real person. I would like to know more about just her character, because someone who's sort of torn between, you know, the Stephen Locke character and then her commitment to communism. And she is like working with Trotsky. That's pretty fascinating. I would like to know more about what her journey is. That is a character that could inspire a whole other movie. And I found just generally, she was a very compelling screen presence, and I just wanted to know more about her character, which is where some of my frustration came up front, where I was like, I want to spend more time getting to know these just as characters, free of the romance, because the romance is the least interesting part. That's all like a cliche, versus like the career this woman has, where she stands within history. That's fascinating.
Well, this probably takes us over to dislikes, because I completely agree. It's I always refer to it on the show as the gotcha problem.
Yeah.
Where you want to spend more time with Linda Fiorentino than you do with Anthony Edwards. And I think this is the same thing. I would like to see more from her than I really wanted to see from Stephen Locke. But I suppose that then leads us on to, which we've already discussed, that the fundamental flaw in the relationship is the fact that there is no connection or chemistry between those two characters. And I think one of the reasons it's so flawed is because she's pontificating that she doesn't want to betray communism to Trotsky at one point, but you never feel her connection to it. So you never understand the sacrifice she's making. And so really all she's doing is going back to her lover. So you don't feel any sort of like sympathy for her.
There are moments where you get a sense that she, I mean, of the spy characters, she's probably the closest to a spy we have in the movie. You have a moment, I think like Stephen Locke, I would have to imagine drastic changes were made to that book. You'll have to mention it in your full-length commentary.
£100 a month, please.
I can guarantee this feels pretty Hollywood-esque when you have like a scene where Stephen Locke is sitting there with a coded message, reading it out loud in a room with her like sitting like right in the next room. And this is like 1918 or 17 or whatever, I would imagine the sound insulation was not particularly strong. And if you are getting coded transmissions from Britain that are top secret, you're probably not going to read them out loud as you're decoding them.
To someone who actually has already told me works for the...
Correct.
Communists, yeah. Well, I wrote down in my notes, it's actually a dislike, so I suppose it connects to the section too. Locke is perhaps the dumbest spy we've ever encountered on the show.
Exactly. And like he does that, and that may be like the biggest boneheaded move he makes. He makes a few, but that might be the biggest one. And she takes that information and actually takes it back to her boss. And to me, like the conflict comes in more so when it comes to they want her essentially to get a forged check so that he can be arrested. And that's where for her the conflict comes in of if Stephen Locke is arrested, chances are he is going to be executed. And so I would just like to know more about the conflict within that character. And Stephen Locke, he's a little stuffy as a lead. And a lot of his role within the movie is kind of defined by inaction. It's a lot of him sitting around waiting because nothing's going on and he's getting frustrated about that. And you do get moments where he does. He gets to go and actually, you know, make his pitch to try to prevent the peace. Stuff like that is great. But a lot of it is other characters around him are more active. So whether it is her or whether it's some of those other diplomat guys he's hanging out with who are actively like running out in the streets to go and try to achieve something and getting shot for it. But they are all kind of doing things versus Stephen Locke, who often is confined to a location.
Yeah, he's played as like the leader of the group because he's like negotiating with that general and things like that. But he's not really an active agent in that, if you'll pardon the pun, in any of that work, because they set the meeting up and therefore pushing the agenda forward, really, those friends. I do want to, and that is my next dislike, I want to talk about those friends. Before I pivot, I was just looking at Kay Francis's list of films.
Yeah.
And the first one that popped up is called The House on 56th Street.
The prequel?
Oh, it'd be the sequel, wouldn't it?
92nd, 56th?
Oh, 92nd, you're right. Yeah, it's the prequel. It's only 68 minutes, so look forward to that Spy Master interview on Patreon there. No, what am I talking about?
Interview. We're going back in time.
Yeah, so look out for that on our next Agents in the Field episode on Patreon. I'm sure you'll all be... shooting over to Patreon. I mean, you're already coming over to hear me read the book. So come for the book, stay for 56th Street. That's what I always say.
You know what? Maybe it's time for our second announcement, is that you are actually going to do an audio book of The British Agent and just read it aloud.
I'm doing all the parts.
Unabridged.
Yeah. I will be using, I'll be using British voices for all of them, even the Russians.
Of course.
Yeah, well, so back to the point I was going to say, and I think my top dislike is the film does a lot of work to set up this like group of friends he has. So I think it's Lafarge, you've got Bob Medill, and there's one more I can't find on the list.
Tito Delval.
Tito, thank you. And they're kind of like his posse, like his ambassador friends. I think one's like American, French, maybe Italian, something like that.
Yeah, sure.
Sure. The film never tells you.
Yeah.
So we're just guessing based on accents, which is unfortunate, but we're trying our best.
Also, this movie's accents are all over the place just in general. So, yeah.
Yeah. There's actually, while you're there, there's one scene where I think like Trotsky's in the room, Lenin's in the room, Locke's in the room, and it's meant to be a British guy and a bunch of Russians. But one of the guys working for Russia is just a Brit.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a full on British accent. He's not even trying to have like a slight twang. It's just a, hello, mate. Do you want me to sweep your chimneys?
Like Dick Van Dyke.
Yeah.
There's also a lot of the, classic and common of the time, but the mid-Atlantic accent they would use, where it was sort of that in-between British and North American English. And a lot of actors used that at the time.
The Cary Grant.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I wrote down, because the film does a little bit of work to set this group up. They're kind of like Stephen Locke's friends.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the fact that they're all kind of, they've all got endings to them in their own way. Their stories are ended one way or another, some very abruptly. But it's, I wrote down, these guys remind me of the friends from Taken.
Yeah.
They just show up, they dump exposition.
Oh man, good call.
Play cards and leave.
We just needed a scene of them golfing and taking a phone call.
And a barbecue.
And a barbecue, yeah, yeah. And we need, I guess, a part three where they actually get to do something.
And then one of them's really bad at their job.
Of course.
hang on. Which one is the chap who... which one is the main guy of his friends? He's like the tech guy. I guess that would be William Gargan, right? I guess that would point at being him.
As Bob Medill, the American, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that makes sense. But yeah, so I guess this is the British version of Taken in a sense.
And I mean, some of those endings, one of them, I'm like, is this supposed to be funny? Because there's the part where I believe it's the French one runs out and finds a colonel. He goes, "Well, colonel, I finally found you." And smash cut to them being executed. It's like, okay, like there is like a, you know, dark inevitability to all of this, and it shows the violence that's raging on the streets and how you can just be caught and killed instantly. But at the same time, just the smash cut was like something you would see almost in a sitcom or something.
I never get this in films, and I maybe because I have been faced with death a few times in my life, actually. So I can't really speak to this particular scenario though personally. But whenever I see this in films or TV, when someone's being like marched to their death, I just think, why the F are you walking?
Yeah.
Oh, I'll just neatly stand against this wall, thank you. Oh, you want me to make a meter distance between the other guys? Sure thing, governor. I don't buy that for an absolute second.
The one that kind of made me laugh was when, you know, Bob the American is captured and being tortured, and I could not tell how they were torturing him. Could you tell what they were doing?
Look, they were tickling him.
That's what it looked like. It looked like they were doing like wet willies in his ear or something.
Stop. Oh.
But it was like, you know, and again, this is a 1934 American film, and it was a real like American, like, you'll never get it out of me. And he's kind of wisecracking his way through the torture and everything. And I'm like, that sounds about right.
Mm, yeah.
I enjoyed that character. I really did.
That's what it is. I would have liked a little bit more of those guys because they were kind of fun to be around. It was quite fun. But that's what happens when you give people unique personalities and some like quirks. Whereas I don't think Stephen Locke had a quirk.
I think the biggest problem here was they were basing it around a real story, around this, you know, Lockhart guy. And so often, especially like when I see biopics of this time, I've seen a number of them of the 30s and 40s, is that they play the character that they are inhabiting, who's a real person, incredibly straight, where it's like, this person has no faults whatsoever. And often that comes across as kind of bland. And I found Stephen Locke kind of bland.
Yeah. I was just about to make a comparison to him in my head, but I couldn't think of who I was thinking of. But it might come back to me. But yeah, he is, milquetoast.
Yeah.
Like there's nothing like... He looks nice. Mm-hmm. Easy on the eye, that chap. I can see why he was a star of film. I get that completely. But I couldn't pick him out of a lineup.
And like Leslie Howard, I've seen in a number of things where he's like really charming. I think of like the movie Pygmalion, which he did back in the day. That was another Best Picture project movie for me that I ticked off. But he's like really charming in that. There's a lot of movies of this era. This one, he has moments. Like, this is a young diplomat here, and someone, you know, they keep saying, oh, you're so young, you're not an old man with a long beard, like so many of the other, you know, diplomats that he's kind of working around. So there is like a youth aspect to him. I just wanted a little more of a spark to him, because he's a little too stiff for me.
Yeah, you're right, though. He has like moments of like almost comedy at times, especially with our man Pooba.
Yeah.
But then like, he'll then just pensively look out of a window for 5 minutes.
Right.
And that's not really riveting. And then like all the romance is not particularly captivating. So you just sort of go, okay, bring back Pooba.
Poor Pooba. And Pooba is like his assistant that he names Pooba, and Pooba pays horribly for being his assistant.
he really goes down swinging, that Pooba.
He like, does.
He's defending that embassy till his last dying breath.
There is a moment, though, getting back to Locke at the end, where Elena Mora has come to try to help him because he's in this munitions warehouse, or I guess it was a building, but whatever. He's surrounded by munitions. The Russians, or the Soviets, I guess at this point, if the Soviets are in power, are coming to take over and basically execute him. And she gets ahead of them and goes in, and they have like 5 minutes before the Soviet forces are going to open fire and blow him up, most likely. And she goes in, and it turns into the scene where she's like cuddling with him on a couch as a ticking clock is going down. This, her character knows what's coming. And I'm watching her face play out of like the tension of like she wants to be with them, but she knows they have mere moments until they're both going to be killed if she stays. And I'm buying everything she's selling in that moment. He has this glazed over expression, and I'm just like, this dude is so dull. He's so dull.
I'm going to take you to a place in Cumbria. It's so nice. We can start. It goes, one of the advertising parts of this, like maybe it's in Surrey or it's in Cumbria. He wants to buy a little house in a village. It's apparently on Sundays, they all get dressed up to the nines and then stand outside and just look.
Yeah.
In silence. That's what they do. It sounds like something out of like Shaun of the Dead. Or Hot Fuzz, sorry. Hot Fuzz, yeah. Where the townsfolk are just like completely like brainwashed. Maybe that is where he wanted to move to. But I'm glad you mentioned the ending, because that's something I had, probably my last dislike I wanted to bring up. And I get this is based on a true story. Maybe it's loosely based on a true story. So this maybe happened to Arch Locke. What's his name again? Sorry?
Lockhart. Lockhart's his real name.
I should remember that because of the character Flashheart from the Blackadder TV show. But so, as you can set up, they're in this house. The Soviets are about to blow them up to kill Locke, because Locke is a wanted man because he is a foreign agent against the Soviet state. And basically, you think their number's up. You hear like the guns are going off. They're shooting out the windows. Elena thinks it's all over. It's not, because the bells start ringing, conveniently due to factoring into his sentence about this perfect village that he wants to live in. And apparently Lenin is fine. Lenin has woken up.
It's a deus ex Lenina.
Can I admit something to you, Cam?
What?
I had the same thing in my notes.
Hell yes. This is why we are co-hosting this podcast.
I will send you a photo afterwards just for proof, everyone. I need to prove this to Cam, because it's not some like podcast trickery. Yeah, deus ex Lenina. He saves the day, I guess. Lenin is saving lives. And so he gets to just leave the country with Elena, I guess.
I say there is zero chance any of that played out in real life the way that it does in the movie. Zero chance. It's kind of ridiculous in the movie. And you have the bells, you know, going back and forth. And I think they say, like, stop the terror, stop the terror. It's like, okay, fine. I mean, and also, not only that, not only do they get away just scot-free because Lenin has awoken and apparently said stop the terror.
Lenin has awoken.
But yeah, it cuts to them getting on a train to leave. And also, the American Bob is out asking for gum again. So clearly they let him go too. He didn't get executed.
No, he had to get his gum.
Yeah.
Like they needed to resolve the gum situation. They left the plot thread dangling. They had to sew that up, Cam.
That was his whole character, really. It was the gum thing.
He had more than Stephen Locke.
Although, I mean, I guess we do have that Stephen Locke enjoys the whole bean versus the ground coffee. So we do have that.
No, absolutely. We'll always have the whole bean.
That's right. Mm. That's right.
Well, I think before we drift on over to the knock list, Cam, I mean, this is an 80-minute film. So we're not going to have an hour and a half's worth for you this week, folks. Well, I have a couple of quick notes. I mean, the film opens, apart from the title card, with this weird, like, credit sequence out of, like, an 80s sitcom where you've just got, like, the actor's name and, like, a gurning face for each person so you know who they are, because the film doesn't take any time to set any characters up particularly. But I found that a really weird intro to the film. Did you catch that?
Yeah, it's the sort of thing you would see in the end credits of, say, the movie Predator, for example. They do it there.
Okay.
You'll see it the odd time. I would suspect in that period, it was more like, because it's Warner Brothers, right? And you're all working with your actors you have under contract.
Mm.
And so I would imagine a lot of it is they want the audience to match the faces to these characters so that you'll remember Warner Brothers actors, because they're trying to make stars, right?
Okay. I get that. That makes sense. My next note was based on old Pooba announcing the arrival of Stephen Locke. I just want people to announce when I arrive at places now.
I'm willing to do that in Las Vegas this summer.
Well, I'm getting married. You might have to.
Oh, good call. Good call.
Yeah. What about you?
There was a line that really made me laugh, where when they're at that tavern and the singer comes over to their table and there's like the alcohol that she's going to drink. And one of the guys says, "If her eyes don't water, she's not a good girl."
I had to look that line up, but it made me like, ooh.
That is some 1930s morality going on right there.
are they drinking an Istanbul Express?
I don't know. What does that mean?
Do you not remember that from Condor Man?
Oh, it's been... Those were on fire, right?
Yes. Okay. That's true. They were on fire. These were not on fire, folks. It was not an Istanbul Express, and hardly a double or a triple.
Yeah. But that line, it's so 1930s chauvinistic, but it was one where I couldn't help but laugh when I heard it.
I heard it, and I was like, did I hear that? And I had to go look up like the quotes on IMDb. It's one of the only two quotes referenced on IMDb.
Yeah.
So someone else has been like, huh? And written it down too. Now, I had one last note, and it's more of a question.
Okay.
Me and you are both noted from very early on in the show that we are work to live, not live to work kind of people.
Yeah.
Stephen Locke feels like a live to work kind of guy. He's sitting in that embassy. He hasn't been told what to do. He could just sit on his hands and not do anything. What would you do?
Well, he's just kind of saying, well, they forgot about me. I would have been charging out of there at the first drop of a hat like so many others were. I would not have been still sitting around with those three other dudes playing cards.
Yeah, I think I'm the same. I would have been on that first train out of the soon-to-be USSR.
And that's something I would imagine the book probably would have dealt with as to exactly why he didn't get evacuated with everyone else.
Well, eventually he's given orders to stay and try and stop them from signing a peace treaty with the Germans.
Eventually.
But there's a big old gap there, and I think it's quite the risk. But then I get the whole idea that he's like kind of like a quite gung-ho trying to prove himself guy, whereas, you know, he's quite young in his role, as we pointed out. So he's kind of trying to prove his point, like he's up for the task, I suppose.
I guess. I mean, maybe it's just that youthful. I feel invincible, and I'm in no hurry.
I don't feel youthful or invincible.
No.
So, yeah, I'll take the first train, and I'll take all the gum with me.
Yep, no kidding.
Right, well, speaking of trains, let's hop on board. Head straight on over to Knoxville. Never used that before. That's weird. Cam, British agent, is it making the knock list?
No, this one isn't making the knock list for me. We talked about some of the other 1930s movies we've covered, and I just think there's a few examples there that have held up better. I'd be pointing people in the direction of 39 Steps, for example. If you're looking for a 1930 spy film that's fantastic, I would point to that one. Or even The Man Who Knew Too Much original version, even Mata Hari, probably over this one. I think this one is probably going to be more interesting for people that are real history buffs who would like to see a 1930s take on this particular time and place. But I think people looking for just like a kind of brisk involving spy film, they might find some barriers preventing them from enjoying this one fully.
I would agree. It's a no for me too. I mean, you didn't mention Spy in Black, which came out in 39.
Right. Yeah, I forgot about that. Yeah.
Only because I just checked it. It's not off the top of my head. Don't worry. Even that's a far more involved story with, I think, a better connection, a better love story.
Yeah.
In that one too. I would say check out any of the ones you just mentioned or Spy in Black before this. It's not the worst film we've ever watched on this show.
No.
By any stretch.
And we talked about House on 92nd Street. Like, that was one that felt very creaky and had it aged quite poorly. Whereas I would say this one aged in some ways, but feels like it holds up a little bit better than, say, House on 92nd Street.
You could tell there's a talented filmmaker in there.
Yeah.
I think this would probably only be the recommend for, I don't know, enthusiasts of World War One history, perhaps, that have it like that know the story, so have it already had it contextualized, and it's more about people playing within the realm that you understand. But if you are anyone with a general knowledge of that period of time, I think you will struggle to watch this film.
And it's kind of insane to me that Michael Curtiz directs The Adventures of Robin Hood 4 years later. And you just watch that movie and how timeless it feels. And you go like, holy smokes. Like, just the leap in production quality of movies that happened in a very short span of time is so mind-boggling to me.
Which is crazy as well, because we just read, I think by this point, or soon to be by this point, we'll be tackling Robin Hood Prince of Thieves on our Patreon exclusive Agents in the Field series with old Kevin Costner. So yeah, check that out if you want to hear our thoughts on that film over on patreon.com/spyhards. But in terms of this week's film, British Agent, it's two no's, and as such it's not making the knock list, and the dossier on the film is complete and filed as classified. Cam, what are we doing next week?
Yes, we are tackling the 2021 World War II spy thriller, Munich, The Edge of War, starring George MacKay. This is one, it's on Netflix, and many people have seen it. I have not, and why not remedy that?
Yeah, it's quite the contrast from this week's film. One you can barely get a hold of, and one that's basically available absolutely everywhere. We thought we would change it up and go for quite a recent one too. We tend not to go too recent with our films, but over the next couple of months we've got a couple of 2021, 2022 films coming out that we're reviewing. Just sort of change it up a little bit. So yeah, check out that. And also next week we'll have a Spy Master interview with the writer of the film, Ben Power, on the Friday. So a double bill next week. Any Munich Edge of War fans or people that like that era, check it out next week. And we once again ask, if you like what you hear on the show, please consider leaving us a 5-star review wherever you get your podcasts, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Podchaser, anything like that. It helps discovery of the show and basically just shares the Spy Hard love. And speaking of, do not forget to follow us discreetly on social media at Spy Hards. That's SPYHARDS on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. But until next week, listeners, just remember, poor old Pooba.
He never introduced himself by name, and then he excused himself, and there I was. I was now communicating with somebody from the KGB.
He exposed more than 1,600 Soviet bloc intelligence officers, and his information led to the breaking of some of the most serious KGB and Polish intelligence spy rings in the West.
Just two short excerpts from the Cold War Conversations podcast. Go check us out wherever you listen to your podcasts.